गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू, माय नेम इज आशुतोष रस्तोगी। इन आर लास्ट लेक्चर वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट इवोल्यूशन ऑफ मोबाइल कम्युनिकेशन एंड स्पेक्ट्रम एलोकेशन, वेयर वी हैव डिस्कस सेवरल सेलुलर कम्युनिकेशन सिस्टम्स सच एज योर 1G एंड 2G कम्युनिकेशन सिस्टम्स। सो नाउ इन दिस पर्टिकुलर लेक्चर वी विल गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू आर डिस्कशन एंड वी विल स्टार्ट डिस्कसिंग योर अपग्रेडेशन पाथ, दैट इज फ्रॉम 2G टू 3G। सो नाउ दिस पर्टिकुलर स्लाइड इज शोइंग द GSM इवोल्यूशन टू 3G, that is how we move forward from your GSM to 3G. So initially we'll be having GSM, that is your 9.6 kilobits per second in one time slot GSM data, which is also called as your CSD, that is your circuit switch data. So then we have moved forward your high speed circuit switch data. So it is dedicated to four time slots for data connection to provide 50 kilobits per second. So it is just lump sum, just like that. In one time slot, we'll be having 9.6 kilobits per second. So we have combined four time slots in order to get almost data rate of 50 kilobits per second. So we basically have combined four circuit switch data, which is good for real time applications as GPRS. So obviously, I'm talking about those era of early 2000 where 10 kilobits per second would have been better data rate just to check out certain messages or check out certain stock codes or just to check out your emails. So those types of applications would have been supported with this 50 kilobits per second data rate quite well. Then another variants would have been taking the path as GPRS in order to provide the data rate services. Then from GPRS, we have moved forward for your edge, which is nothing but your enhanced data rate for GPRS enabled nodes. For providing further higher data rate services, we have used 8 PSK modulation schemes or MPSK schemes, which is 3 times improvement in the data rate on short distances. So obviously these are the techniques by which we have increased or enhanced the data rate of our network so that individual user can access much larger or much different amount of applications or services. So then some of the GPRS have directly confined to your WCDMA radio interface, that is your wideband code division multiple access, which further provides much larger amount of data rate, whereas certain users have moved from edge towards your WCDMA. Since this is the present state of our technology, to nowadays also for radio interfaces, we are using wideband code division multiple access techniques. So now CDMA 2000 evolution to 3G. So just now we have already told you that in 2G systems, we are basically having two sort of variants. Number one is your GSM, which is nothing but your European standards. And second one is your CDMA. So how CDMA 2000 evolved to 3G? So this particular slide will going to give the information about this. So initially we'll be having CDMA, or you could say your IS95 standards, which basically providing us 14.4 kilobits per second data rate. Then IS95A would have been evolved to your IS95B, or you could say that version A to version B. So which basically using multiple code channels, data rate up to 64 kilobits per second, and many operators gone directly to 1x RTT. So this is the extension path where we have basically combined four different channels in order to provide that much amount of data rate, that is your 64 kilobits per second. So then some of the operators would have moved forward for your 1x RTT directly. This is what we are talking about. So CDMA 2000, that is also called as your 1x RTT, that is your single carrier RTT. That was the first phase in CDMA 2000 evolution that can easily coexist with the existing IS95 air interface. So all those users or standards are working simultaneously. So these are basically showing the different releases, release 0, release A, and release A is having much better data rate supporting capability, that is maximum 384 kilobits per second. So all those releases are exploiting or utilizing the same core network, which is your traditional CDMA systems, that is your IS95 standard. So from 1x RTT, some of them would have been evolved for 1x eVDO, that is evolved data rate for data optimized So this is the third phase of CDMA 2000 evolution, which is the standardized version of Qualcomm high data rate, that is your HDR. It basically adds CDMA components beneath the code components. So this is how they have improved their data rate services, and they are providing the data rate up to your 2 Mbps, so which would have been considered as your 3G systems for the new or existing spectrum. So 1x EVDO was further would have been enhanced as your 1x EVDV, and 1x EVDV would have been further emerged as your CDMA 2000 or 3x RTT. So this 3x RTT basically signifying that it is having 3 times the data rate of your 1x RTT. So now we're going to discuss about your IS-95A. We had already seen the extension path. So although if we want, we can skip all those points, but as it is not in use nowadays. Nowadays we are using your 3G systems as well as 4G systems. So CDMA systems have already stopped their telephone services. So but still we are discussing history. So just take a look what is so peculiar or specific about your interim standard 95A. So it was commercially introduced in 1995 with IS-95A or CDMA-1. So IS-95A is the CDMA-based second generation standard for mobile communication, and the following are the key aspects of the standard. So obviously it was initially introduced to provide certain additional functionality or security feature to your mobile communication system. So it was initially was used by your US Department of Defense for secure communication. So CDMA was commercially introduced in 1995. It supports the data rate of up to 14.4 kilobits per second, and it has been used exclusively for circuit switched voice. So for channel coding, or you could say that for data or error correction detection, they are exploiting convolution codes, and the modulation techniques they are exploiting is your BPSK, which is your highly energy efficient scheme. Whereas the second version or IS-95B or CDMA-1 is the evolved version of IS-95, that is in the core network we'll be again having same CDMA network and is designated to as 2.5G. So second version of IS-95A would have been called as your 2.5G, or you could say that would have been called as your, the second version of IS-95 is your IS-95A to your IS-95B, and this IS-95B would have been considered as your 2.5G systems example. So IS-95B maintains the physical layer of IS-95A, but due to the enhanced MAC layer, it is capable of providing for higher speed data services. So the following are the key aspects of the standards, and what are they? The theoretical data rates are up to 115 kilobits per second, and generally experienced rates of 64 kilobits per second. So second version would have been providing almost double capacity of your general rate, or that we have maintaining with the help of four via clubbing 4 different channels. So additional voice codes and PN sequence mask, which enables our mobile users to be assigned up to the 8 forward and reverse code channels simultaneously, thus enabling the higher data rates. So obviously we are not at all talking about the frame structures. So code channels which are transmitted at full data rates during a data burst. So again, in the second version also, we are using convolution codes for channel coding, that is your error correction and detection, and the BPSK modulation schemes would have been used in the second version also. So CDMA 2001X, so it supports theoretical data rate of up to 307 kilobits per second, which with generally experienced rates of 144 kilobits per second. So in general, they are providing 144 kilobits per second, but the maximum theoretical data rate that it could support, that is your CDMA 2001X, is your 307 kilobits per second. So the newly introduced quadrature PCH of CDMA 2000 enables a mobile to be informed about when it needs to monitor FCCTH and paging channel, thus improving on the battery life. So this is again too much specific about your control channels of your CDMA systems. So although we have not discussed about it, so I'm not going to go through into a greater detail of that. So introduction to radio configuration, transmission formats characterized by the physical layer parameters, such as data rates, modulation characteristics, and spreading rates. So RCS helps in providing for additional data rates also. So the quality and the eraser indicator bits, that is QIB and EIB, on the reverse power control subchannels. So this helps in indicating the base station about the bad frames or the loss frames, or we could say that these are basically indicating which frames have been received properly and which frames are lossy, or where we'll be having data loss, so that they can be retransmitted. So this would have been considered as a kind of acknowledgement based analysis, which will going to provide us the information that which of the frames or which information parts we have to retransmit again, so that the information exchange would have been successfully performed. So code channels are transmitted at full data rates during that data burst. So again, they are also using convolutional as well as turbo codes for channel coding schemes. Modulation techniques that we are using is your QPSK. So obviously, if we talk about the data rate, the QPSK is having the double data rate capability in comparison to your PSK systems. So why I just using this and different modulation schemes, that is your QPSK in comparison to BPSK, we are in a state to double the data rate available. So CDMA 2003X, it is offering the data rate speeds up to 2 Mbps. So obviously we are talking about the 3G version of your CDMA variant. So using three standards, that is 1.25 MHz standard with a 5 MHz band. So they are basically exploiting this particular standard, or we could say that they are exploiting 125 megahertz channel bandwidth within that 5 megahertz band. So leveraging deployment experiences and manufacturers' learning curves of today's widely adopted commercially available CDMA systems. So obviously this is not true about for today's scenario, since I had already mentioned that CDMA has already stopped the services of voice communication. Somehow they are being present just to provide certain sort of internet services. So using convolution as well as turbo coding techniques, again they are also using as a channel coding technique. So using QPSK as the modulation technique. So this is the specification about your CDMA 2003X. So now 1X EVDO. So it is supporting a data rate of up to 2.4 Mbps. So obviously in terms of data rate, it is having much better. So having no background compatibility with the CDMA 2000, so it is not possessing any backward compatibility with the CDMA 2000. So including two inner operable modes, an integrated 1x mode optimized for voice and medium data rate, and a 1x EV mode optimized for non-real time, high capacity, high speed data and internet access. So this is not compatible to its backward version. They are basically providing better data rate services in comparison to your previous one. So it's providing adaptive rate operation with respect to the channel conditions. So it's providing adaptive modulation as well as coding, as we had already discussed. It is also providing micro diversity via radio selection. So which specific sort of channel we have to exploit. So via selecting that particular frequency range, it can provide certain macro diversity. Also providing an always on operation of 1x EVDO terminals in the active state. So this is just only for indicating purpose. It is not at all transmitting all the time, but yes, it has been connected with the serving base station, you could say that, continuously or more. So using a multi-level modulation format such as your QPSK, 8PSK and 16QM, so these are different MRE signaling schemes. So with the help of these multi-level modulation formats, they can provide much larger data rate. So in 1x EVDV, that is your backward compatible with the CDMA 2000, so your 1x EVDV or it is having the backward compatibility with your CDMA 2000. That is, EVDV can be easily extended to operate in 3x mode. 3x here, 3x representing 3 times much larger data rate mode under the framework of the current system. So forward peak data rate is about 3.072 Mbps, and reverse peak data rate would have been given as your 451.2 किलोबिट्स पर सेकंड। तो एडिशन ऑफ थ्री न्यू चैनल्स टू फॉरवर्ड लिंक एंड रिवर्स लिंक फॉर द पैकेट डेटा ऑपरेशन एंड इट्स सपोर्ट। सो अडैप्टिव मॉड्यूलेशन एंड कोडिंग स्कीम्स इन योर 1x EVDV इज अगेन योर QPSK, 8PSK एंड 16QN जस्ट लाइक योर 1x EVDO। वेरिएबल फ्रेम ड्यूरेशन वुड हैव बीन यूज्ड इन योर EVDV। मोबाइल स्टेशन कैन सेलेक्ट वन ऑफ द N बेस स्टेशंस, बेसिकली इट कुड कनेक्ट साइमल्टेनियसली मल्टीपल बेस स्टेशंस एंड इट हैज टू सेलेक्ट वन बेस स्टेशन। सो DTS ट्रांसमिशन सपोर्टेड फॉर सेविंग बैटरी पावर। So this particular slide is showing the upgradation path of your CDMA towards your 3G systems. That is, initially in your 2G systems, we'll be having IS-95 standard, which would have been developed as your second version or second variant, that is called as your interim standard IS-95B, which is much superior in comparison to your IS-95A. Then IS-95B would have been developed in order to give much more superior data rate so that we could enter into the stage where we can call them as your 3G systems. So these are the variants: CDMA 2000 1X RTT, CDMA 2000 1X EV DV DO, as well as CDMA 2000 3X RTT. So these are the different variants. These are the different 3G variants of your CDMA standards. So whereas other 2G standards such as your GSM and IS-136, which is nothing but your TDMA based systems, they have also taken the extension path like this. They have, some of the GSM service providers have directly moved on to your HSCSD, that is your high speed circuit switch data, whereas some of them have enabled your GPRS so that in order to increase the data rate services features. Some of the users again have gone towards your edge to further increase the data rate services, whereas some of the users have directly moved on to your WCDMA. So in your 3G systems, we will be having your WCDMA, edge, or TD, SCDMA system. So these are the examples of your 3G system. So this 3GPP2, this is your third generation partnership project 2, and this is your third generation partnership project. So this is basically slide is showing the upgradation path from 2G to 3G. So now we are moving forward towards your 3G system. So IMT 2000 pigeon, as we had already mentioned, that the concept of IMT 2000 began as your FTLMTS, that is your future public land mobile telecommunication system. So FTLMTS comprises of both the terrestrial as well as the satellite components. So basically we are talking about a futuristic public land mobile telecommunication system, which is having the mobility like your mobile communication system, whereas the service quality and security just like your landline communication. So this is about your FTLMTS system. So one of the aim is to provide an environment in which global access to the service of the quality comparable to the fixed network would be achievable. This is what I'm talking about. So 3G standards is created by ITUT and is called the IMT 2000. So it was the standard which was have been created by your International Telecommunication Union telecom branch and is called as your IMT 2000. So system that fulfills this IMT 2000 standard is called as your UMTS. So this is the implemented version of your IMT 2000. So IMT 2000 was the vision and UMTS was the implemented version. So as we had already mentioned that in IMT 2000 vision, the overall objective is to provide the common unanimous radio interface so that each and every user will get connected to other user irrespective of the fact that the person to he wants to connect, whether it is belonging to its own network or it is belonging to its another network. So the aim of IMT 2000 is to harmonize the worldwide 3G systems to provide the global roaming. So this is what I'm talking about. So we have to talk about a common unanimous system which can harmonize the worldwide system standard and which can provide the global roaming. I mean, wherever you are, whichever geographical location you are in a state to connect with the network and inter-exchange your information. So UMTS must serve the functions like it supports all services, facilities and applications provided by the existing 2G systems. So first point is it must have to have some backward compatibility. That is, all the 3G systems must support their 2G quality of systems to the fixed network. So the quality of service would have been equivalent to the fixed network, since they would have been considered as your highly secure, as well as the call quality is much better in your wired communication systems. So the vision was something like the quality of service would have been equivalent to your fixed network. So please keep in mind, I'm talking about the IMT 2000 vision. They have not at all implemented with the same strength or standards as they are talking about. That is another question. But these are the visions over which your IMT 2000 is based upon. So provide a new range of broadband multimedia types of services. So these are the visions of your IMT 2000. So this particular slide is showing about the IMT 2000 radio interfaces. Here we'll be having IMT vision, and these particular blocks are showing different sort of radio interfaces. First one is your WCDMA, that is your wideband code division multiple access, universal terrestrial radio access FDD. So this has mostly been deployed, and this is your CDMA 2000, which is your CDMA variants of 3G standards. And this one is your TDMA code division multiple access, which would have been implemented as a UTRA as well as the TDD. Then UWC Edge as well as DECT. So these are the standards related to your cordless telephony, digitally enhanced cordless telephony. And these four are the radio interfaces that would have been exploited in different global region. Suppose such as this particular standard would have been popularly used in your China, and these are your rest of the world. So all these three standards, that is your WCDMA, CDMA 2000 and TD-CDMA, for multiple access environment, they are exploiting as your CDMA. And for your some portion of your TD-CDMA would have been implemented with TDMA, whereas some of the portion would have been implemented with the CDMA. So this particular slide is also showing that some portion of UWC I-136, or you could say your Edge, as well as DECT for multiple access environment, they would have been exploiting TDMA, and some portion of DECT would have been using FDMA as your multiple access environment. Here one important point is that is some portion of the spectrum by this color. This dark color is showing the unpaired spectrum, and this light color is showing the paired spectrum. So what do you mean by paired spectrum and unpaired spectrum? So paired spectrum means whatever amount of uplinking frequency we have, that much similar bandwidth would have been allocated for your downlink too. Whereas in the unpaired spectrum, it is not fixed. That is, for uplinking frequency and downlinking frequency, the bandwidth might get different. So now we're going to discuss about your UMTS. UMTS is the European vision of your 3G systems. It is an upgrade from GSM via GPRS or Edge. So this is basically an upgrade. It would have been upgraded from GSM via GPRS then to Edge. So this is how we have enabled our 3G system. So UMTS is nothing but is your universal mobile telecommunication system, which is the implemented version of your IMT 2000. So the standardization work for UMTS is carried out by the third generation partnership project. So the data rate of UMTS are 144 kilobits for rural, 384 kilobits for urban outdoor public, and 2 Mbps, or you could say your 2048 kilobits per second for indoor and low range outdoor. So if any person would have been attained this particular amount of data rate, then we could say that they have achieved your 3G services. So for a rural sort of user or subscriber, 144 kilobits per second would have been considered as that user is your 3G user. Whereas for urban environment, that data rate belongs to your 384 kilobits per second. And similarly for indoor or low range outdoor user or subscriber, the speed turns out to be your 2048. So in 3G systems or UMTS systems, they should provide virtual home environment. I mean, wherever users are, whether it is roaming or it is in home environment, whatever services it has subscribed or it is using in your home environment, so that much amount of services with the same strength or intensity, it should get the similar type of services in the visiting location too. So it should provide some virtual home environment sort of feeling to the user. So this is one of the feature about your UMTS. It has also provide some high spectrum efficiency, that is with minimum amount of bandwidth, it should support larger amount of information flow. So this particular slide is showing UMTS cell types. So depending upon the geographical area that any particular cell will going to cover, we can describe different types of UMTS cell. So if we closely observe that the smallest cell size that is available, that is your home cell, whose coverage area limits to home only, next type of cell structure comprise of complete building. So if we closely observe that this particular structure is showing the pico cell structure. So pico cell is the smallest cell which is covering the complete building. You could say that your hotspot area, such as your railways as well as your airports, etc. So in contrast with your pico cell, the coverage area of microcell is much larger, which basically covers the urban area. So whose coverage area can confine to the coverage of multiple buildings. Next type of cell is your macro cell, which is covering your suburban region. So the cell structure or cell size of macro cell is much larger than your micro cell. Here the coverage area would have been extended towards the citywide connectivity, whereas the global cell structure, or you could say that your satellite cell structure, would confine of entire city or group of cities. So if we talk about the coverage region, satellite cell structure would be the largest one and home cell will be the minimum one. So this is all about your UMTS cell types. So this particular slide is showing the UMTS network architecture. Initially we'll be having a user equipment. So the mobile system that we have studied in our 2G systems, which is the combination of your SIM card as well as mobile equipment, here also same UE stands for user equipment, and that is the combination of your USIM, that is your universal SIM card, with mobile equipment. So the combination of UE plus ME would have been called as your UE, or you could say that the combination of USIM plus user equipment would have been called as your UE. And UTRAN is nothing but it is your universal terrestrial radio access network. So the wireless connectivity between the UE and the UTRAN or universal terrestrial radio access network would have been confined with your UU interface, and this UTRAN is having the connectivity with the core network, which comprises of different logical modules such as your MSC, and it is again having different sort of registers, and at the backside they will be having connectivity with several different infrastructure network. So this is the core network. This core network and UTRAN is having the connectivity with the LU interfaces. So now this is the brief description about the UMTS network architecture that we have studied in our last slide. So UMTS network architecture consists of three basic components. Number one is your user equipment. Second is your UMTS terrestrial radio access network that we have described. And third one is your core network. So the user equipment communication with UTRAN using the UU interfaces, whereas the communication between the universal terrestrial radio access network and the core network is achieved via the LU interfaces. These UU and LU, these are just you have considered right now, these are kind of names of interfaces, although the interfaces are certain signaling schemes which characterize that how two devices will going to intercommunicate with each other. So this particular figure is showing the UTRAN network architecture. If you closely observe that, this is what we have studied in your UMTS network architecture. We'll be having a UE which is having the connectivity with your UTRAN, that is your universal terrestrial radio access network. So basically UE is having the connectivity with this node B. So here your BTS or base station would have been called as your node B. So in 3G we will going to call base station as your node B, and node B is having connectivity with your radio network controller. If you closely observe the basic structure of your 2G systems, so there we will be having a mobile station which is having the connectivity with the base station. Then base station will get connectivity with the base station controller. So here also in the similar type, we'll be having the similar sort of hierarchy. Here also we'll be having the user equipment, which is having the wireless connectivity with the node B, which is nothing but your base station. And the interfaces between UE and node B would have been defined as your UU interface. And in the similar manner, intercommunication between the node B, or you could say your BTS, with your RNC. RNC would have been called as your radio network controller. So here your BSC would have been called as your radio network controller. So this radio network controller and node B would having the connectivity, or you could say that your interface through which they will going to intercommunicate with each other is your LUB. And again, the network connectivity between the UTRAN, or you could say that your RNS, that is your radio network subsystem. So the connectivity between the radio network subsystem, radio network system, and the core network is with the LU. And in the similar manner, there are other number of infrastructure part would have been connected with the core network. So this is the UTRAN architecture, or you could say that this is the UTRAN network architecture. So in UMTS network architecture, they basically consist of three basic components. Number one is your core network, which is the heart of your UMTS network architecture. So it basically provides switching, routing, transit for the user traffic. So all the functionalities that would have been achieved by your MSC, that would have been governed with this core network. So core network also contains the databases and the network management functions. So you can consider it as like it is analogous to your mobile switching center or MSC. Then UMTS terrestrial radio access network, or you could say your UTRAN network. RNS provides the call control functions, power control, and the handover switching, as well as the connection to the core network. So as we have already described that RNS is analogous to your base station controller. It is functioning like your base station controller, which is also providing some call control functions. It is also responsible for your power control, as well as handover switching, as well as connection to the core network. Then at last we'll be having user equipment. This is basically end device, which is the terminal work as the air interface counterpart for node B. So this is your end device, which is responsible for initiating as well as terminating the information exchange. So they would have been worked as the terminal through which information or signal exchange will going to take place. So here one thing should keep in mind that the terminal works as the air interface counterpart of node B. Node B is nothing but it is your base station. So the wireless connectivity only exists between the UE and the node B. Apart from that, we'll be having connectivity via some optical fiber cable. So the interface that would have been defined between your node B and your UE is your UU interface. So this is about the spectrum allocation of UMTS. As we had already discussed about the paired as well as unpaired spectrum. So UMTS band that would have been defined is your 1900 megahertz to 2025 megahertz and 2110 megahertz to 2200 megahertz band for 3G transmission. So this spectrum allocation band would have been provided by your ITU. So it has designated 1900 to 2025, that is 125 megahertz band in here, and 2110 to 2200, that is 90 megahertz band in these two megahertz frequency band. So terrestrial UMTS UTRAN, we have subdivided all those frequency bands into these three regions. That is, first band we have described as 1900 to 1980, that is this 1900 to 1980. Second one is your 2010 to 2025, and third one is your 2110 to 2170 megahertz band. So according to this particular figure, as it is showing that we have divided 1900 to 1920 megahertz band as an unpaired, whereas 2010 to 2025, this is also your unpaired. So basically this 15 megahertz band and this 20, that is total 35 megahertz band, would have been your unpaired megahertz, would have been prescribed as your unpaired spectrum. So whereas 1920 to 1980, that is this 60 megahertz band, and 2110 to 2170, this 60 megahertz band, would have been allocated for paired spectrum, that is for uplinking as well as downlinking. We'll be having a paired spectrum. So for bidirectional communication, we could say, generally say that for whenever we'll be having paired spectrum, we can exploit or utilize your FDD for your duplexers, for implementing your duplexers. Whereas in the unpaired spectrum for bidirectional connectivity, we are exploiting your TDD, or you could say your time division duplexing as a duplexing mode of communication. So this particular figure is showing the complete spectrum allocation that would have been allocated by ITU for 3G systems. So now 4G systems. So in the first column, it is showing generation. Then second column, it is showing your name, and third is your speed. So obviously, as we had discussed, that the example of your 4G systems are your LTE, that is your long-term evolution, the current mobile phones we are using nowadays, and second is your WiMAX. So these are the examples of your 4G systems. So the typical speed generated by your or supported by your LTE is your 100 to 200 megabits per second, whereas WiMAX is also supporting 100 to 200 megabits per second. So these are the 4G systems examples, and this is their typical speeds that it is offered by your 4G systems. So the idea about your 4G wireless technology, this particular slide will going to give a brief idea about that. So 4G being developed with the following objectives, what are they? The speeds up to 50 times higher than the 3G systems. So the typical speed of 3G would have been maximized up to 50 times. So in that particular case, we will going to say that we are running or using next generation systems, that is your 4G systems. So to accomplish multi-service capacity, integrating all the mobile technologies that exist simultaneously. So to accomplish multi-service capacity, we have to integrate all the mobile technologies that exist. And second objective is this network must be available to the users anytime, anywhere. I mean, irrespective of the fact, wherever user are, he or she must get the network connectivity, or he or she should be in a state to connect with the network and transmits its information. So low bit cost is essential where high volume of the data are transmitted. So it must have to implement as the cheapest mechanism available for the communication. So to be able to use 4G mobile networks, mobile terminals must be able to choose from available wireless networks to one with use with the specific service. So this is the specific criteria about your WiMAX. That is, it is offering that if you got the signals from a specific WiMAX terminal, you can directly connect with that. But in present era also, user does not have the functionality to connect with the whomsoever service provider it wants to. So this was the basically idea that in 4G network, in 4G mobile network, user must have the capability to connect the service providers from where it is getting much better services. But in the present implemented scenario, it is not possible. So what are the key challenges for 4G systems? So basically, we have to confine different wireless standards such as your wireless personal area network, wireless local area network, wireless metropolitan area network, wireless wide area network. We have to combine all those structures with IP, and this complete combination would have been called as your 4G systems. So this integration of all those heterogeneous network to frame or form a common network, it is the major key challenge for the implementation of 4G systems. So these are the references. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.